Now, he had an affinity with Antarctica and a passion for exploration that took him to the far reaches of the planet. Sharon Ferguson chronicles Sir Ed's achievements.
When New Zealand's Scott base in Antarctica turned 50, its founder returned for the party and reminisced.
I can remember stepping out of the helicopter on this spot here and looking around and thinking to myself, this is it. We can head towards the pole. We can do anything.
And it seems they could do anything.
We wanted to go to the pole, so we got stuck in and we did it.
On January the 4th, 1958, Sir Edmund Hillary, Murray Ellis, Jim Bates, Peter Mulgrew and Derek Wright arrived at the South Pole. They'd completed the first overland journey since Captain Scott.
On a train of farm tractors, they crossed the frozen continent in the footsteps of past heroes.
When we were about 100 miles from the pole, we were fed up with travelling, and I decided that we'd just start up our tractors and keep going until we actually got to the pole. And we drove on and on and on for 90 miles at 3 miles an hour, so we went for 30 hours.
50 years on, this story was still told like it was a casual walk in the park.
We were adequately clothed, even when the average temperature was around about minus 30 Celsius. So I don't quite know why we have all this junk.
In 1960, Sir Ed headed back to the Himalayas on a monster of a mission, believe it or not, to find the Yeti, a clever scheme to ensure a sponsor.
We looked for Yeti footprints, and we got the famous Yeti scalp, and actually brought it to the outside world for scientists to examine. Our final conclusion, I'm afraid, was that the Yeti was probably a mythological creature.
With the funders satisfied, he turned his efforts to altitude research, attempting to climb the fifth highest mountain, Mount Makalu, without oxygen, a peak he'd studied from the top of Everest.
Even though I was standing on the top of the highest mountain in the world, I looked across at Makalu and I mentally worked out a route up that mountain. It's a pretty formidable mountain too.
But on the way up at 20,000 feet, Sir Ed suffered a minor stroke and had to be carried down. In 1977, after fighting several years of depression caused by the loss of his wife and daughter, Sir Ed set out on another adventure, this time on board a jet boat from the mouth of the Ganges through to the Himalayas. He was met by an enormous reception. The river was lined with adorers who regarded him as a living god. In Calcutta, 3 million turned out.
They regarded us as travelling on a holy pilgrimage. And we almost started to have a little bit of this feeling ourselves.
There were many pilgrimages in this life of adventure.
I have a plan.
Even well into his 80s, Sir Ed returned to the frozen continent for the anniversary of the Erebus disaster. The plane crash killed 257 people, including his best friend, Peter Mulgrew.
I have here a poem that has been written about the incident. The mountain. I am here beside my brother, Terror. I am the place of human error. I am beauty and cloud, and I am sorrow. I am tears which you will weep tomorrow.
Well, Nepal and the Sherpa people have been the major focus of Sir Ed's life since conquering Everest. 18 months ago, close-ups, Mark Sainsbury travelled back there with Sir Ed. Despite failing health, the mountaineer was determined to make one last visit to the Sherpa communities high in the Himalayas. And on the chopper ride up, he saw once again the site of his most famous triumph.
Looking at from now, it looks virtually impossible. Absolutely overwhelming experience. After all, I've seen the mountains many times before, but not under these circumstances. And to see those great white peaks towering up in the sky. It really was a most amazing sensation.
He landed in a village briefly and was greeted, as one local said, like a second Dalai Lama. Sir Ed, of course, devoted much of his life trying to improve the lot of the Himalayan people he adored. His charity raised millions for the building of schools, hospitals and roads. Here's Shalene Hearn.
Sherpa children show their adoration for the man whose work helped give them an education. 30 years on and the Sherpa still in awe.
For us, Sherpa is a second Dalai Lama. You know, it's a god for us.
Not content to just conquer Everest, Hillary established the Himalayan Trust in 1960 to battle poverty in the mountain villages of Nepal. The Trust's work has forever changed the landscape of these mountains. Three hospitals, 13 health clinics and more than 30 schools have been built since 1960.
The change of life in last 45 years with the work of the Himalayan Trust on education, health, it is tremendous change.
The Trust has also built bridges and roads into the mountain villages, literally opening up the world to the Sherpa.
You know, he's a superman for us. He's more than a god.
Sir Ed was hands-on. He literally built some of the schools, clinics and bridges the Trust commissioned. And he made lifelong friends along the way. His love for the mountains surpassed only by his love for its people.
The Sherpas have always rather had this feeling that I was going to be around for all time, really.
But in a way, he always will be. The schools, hospitals, roads and lives he's helped build will all serve as memorials to his extraordinary life. Shalene Hearn, One News.
And that is all for this One News special, but we will be back with a half-hour Tonight Bulletin at 10:40. Tako tō mai.